Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining this talk. What is the secure software supply chain and the current state of the PHP ecosystem? Before we begin, let me introduce myself very briefly. My name is Paolo Magnardi. I am the co-founder and CTO of Spark Fabric. Spark Fabric is an Italian company, as you can probably hear from my accent. We are based in Italy. We do a lot of cloud native and Drupal development and cloud infrastructure based mainly on Kubernetes. We maintain some Drupal modules as well. Maybe the most famous one is Web Profiler from Luca Lusso. He's here as well. And he has a presentation tomorrow on how Drupal builds pages. It's a very interesting deep dive. I suggest you to follow that talk. It's tomorrow. I am also part of the advisory board of Linux Foundation Europe. LFE is a newborn foundation, the European branch of the Linux Foundation, with the mission to accelerate the growth of open source in Europe, fostering open source, open standards in the European market, of course. You can visit linuxfoundation.eu if you are interested about the ongoing project and how to be involved as a contributor, or if you have an open source project to be hosted there. You can also find me on my personal blog, paolomagnardi.com, and all the other social channels you see on the slide. Well, let's get started. In this session, I will start by explaining you what is the software supply chain and why it's so important today. Then we will see the state of PHP ecosystem and threats and the mitigations we can put in place with things like digital signatures, software attestations, and SBOM, software bill of materials. And finally, I will do a demo to let you see how these tools work in a real-life scenario. The demo is a recorded video I did yesterday, sadly. I choose this way because the demo is a very network-intensive, and I really want to let you see the things without being affected by connection issues that, you know, when you do a demo, are always there. But you can replicate all the steps we are going to see during the demo. I will provide you a link of a GitHub repo with everything you need to replicate it. So, to understand what is the software supply chain, I want to start with this general definition, which says a supply chain is a network of individuals and companies who are involved in creating a product, delivering it to the consumer. It is generic enough to accommodate everything, basically, any product, from a couple of shoes to a software product of any kind, including Drupal. But open source software has a unique characteristics that differentiate it a lot from all the other industries and products. This diagram comes from the Salsa framework, slsa.dev, which is an open source project created by the OpenSSF Foundation, which is a branch of the Linux Foundation. This project is not a software framework. Instead, it's just a checklist of best practices that we can gradually adopt it to improve the integrity, reducing tampering risks, and finally improve as well the security posture of our packages and infrastructure. As you can see, there are three main groups in which the threats are categorized: source, build, and dependencies. Attackers today commonly exploit dependencies, which remain the weakest link in the security chain. It is estimated that a modern project has an average number of more than 500 packages, dependencies today, and over 90% of our code is in our products is not actually written by us. So now you can imagine how much we depend on unknown actors and how large the attack surface is just on this side. But attacks can occur at any link of the software supply chain, not just dependencies. And these kinds of attacks are increasingly public and disruptive, like the cases SolarWinds, codecov, or Okta, and many, many others. I will show you something about SolarWinds in the next slides. But now, try to imagine the Salsa diagram that we just saw applied to a modern Drupal application. We, of course, start by installing Drupal. Typically, we need to install additional Drupal country modules and other composer dependencies. Then, depending on how we build Drupal, we will need a variable amount of JavaScript dependencies to build our team or other services. In addition to that, we may require other tools such as Python, Go, Rust for implementing AI or such or other stuff we need. On top of that, we have our operating system, which is strictly bound to our application. We may need system libraries for compiling PHP extensions. We may need a specific kernel or other custom binaries, such as the tools we use in Drupal, for example, to convert images. It's a very common case. Then we usually have CI/CD systems with many jobs to do code linting, to do QA, to run tests, to collect metrics, and so on and so forth. Another very common case is also integrating external services to do these kind of things on our code base, like codecov coveralls, code climate. And this means giving basically full access from the external to our code base, to our systems. Then we have to ship our application on the cloud. We have several options today, like AWS, GCP, Azure, whatever we like. And when using cloud platforms, today we have the flexibility to choose from a wide range of services to deploy the application. The services may include Kubernetes, object storage for all the assets, many kind of database, MySQL, Postgres, Redis, Memcache, Lambda functions, and so on and so forth. And lastly, we have our local or cloud development environment, which is today very another word agglomerate of external dependencies. Think to extending your editor with VS Code extensions, or with if you use VI, VI modules, or whatever we use to add feature to our environment. They are dependencies, as the dependencies we use in our applications. And it's also very common that we have access to the cloud platforms from our development environment, maybe to debug, to see the logs, to check the metrics and such. As we have already seen in the Salsa diagram, no point in this chain is free of threats, especially when the map of services is so complex and interconnected together. What we see here is maybe the biggest case in the history of cybersecurity attacks. This was indeed the case which sparked the global interest around the secure software supply chain, especially in the open source world. This case happened in 2020 to this company called SolarWinds. They are a major IT company based in the US, and one of their flagship products called Orion, designed to do network monitoring at large scale for data center, was compromised by a malware, which was then shipped to all SolarWinds customers as a regular standard security update. It was later discovered that this kind of compromise was in the SolarWinds build system, especially in the point C of the Salsa framework, where a very sophisticated malware was designed to activating itself and injecting malicious code right before the compilation phase. This attack went undetected for 4 months, and from that point on, all the new versions of Orion contained this kind of malware that was designed just for spying reasons. The biggest tech giants like Microsoft, Intel, Cisco were affected, but even the most important national security agencies like the Pentagon, the Homeland Security, the National Nuclear Security, and many, many other important agencies, public entities, private entities, and worldwide national states. This case was so big and concerning that the US Congress invited the CEO of SolarWinds and the president of Microsoft to testify on the case at the Congress to understand why companies that are supposed to protect us from cyber attacks was instead themselves victims of a long-running, a large-scale attack like this. Since 2019, these kind of attacks have increased by more than 700% per year. There are several reasons behind this. First and foremost, there is a great global demand for open source, which is good, as we work in this field, but open source projects today, as I said, requires thousands of external dependencies to build a new product. And usually projects lack proper security tools or even the knowledge of the complete set of dependencies we are using to build our software. But even improving an invention of new attacks like typo squatting, dependency confusion, injection of malicious code, and recently even the protestware attacks where authors of projects basically sabotage their project to protest against something. It was there were two famous cases, the Node.js libraries Colors and Faker, who had this kind of attack. And these attacks, as you can see, have also a big global economic impact. Losses have already estimated to be around 46 billion and are expected to exceed 80 billion by 2026. And all these reasons together led government to work on new cybersecurity laws. US government started first promulgating the National Cybersecurity Strategy just a month ago, in March 2023, which is a long-term strategy to improve the security posture of organizations and explicitly talking for the first time about making software vendors liable for insecure software. And software vendors will also be required to satisfy new security requirements specifically designed for supply chain lines, such as publishing software bill of materials alongside their software products. The EU Commission also worked on a law that is called the Cyber Resiliency Act, the CRA. You'll probably hear a lot about this in the next few weeks or months. The proposal of this law is very good, it wants basically regulate all the products that incorporates digital elements, which includes any product that can run software, basically. It is the equivalent of the CE mark we see in the electronic device, but specifically designed for software. The implementation of this law has caused a major concern within the open source communities right now, because even if there are specific exclusions for open source, the boundaries who will be liable for are not yet quite clear. In fact, at the current form, everyone who publishes software via the internet is potentially liable for CRA penalties, and they are quite big in some cases. So, if you're interested in this subject, and you should, working on this field, you would like to learn more or stay engaged, you can scan this QR code or follow the link to subscribe. This will keep you informed about the latest CRA updates from Linux Foundation Europe and other open source foundations. The good news is that also the response from the community has been strong and very coordinated. We see here a bunch of logos of products, tools, new foundation, new standards or improved standards with the aim to assist companies, professionals, public and private sectors to create a more secure software industry altogether. Well, let's see now the state of the PHP ecosystem and how much is affected by all this issue we have seen so far. I want to start by looking at the history of package management in PHP. This is an history who begins in 1999, so many, many years ago, when Stig Becken wanted to include in the PHP runtime something to manage in a programmatic way external and high-quality dependencies. The name of this project was PEAR, which stands for PHP Extensions and Application Repository. It was, for the time, a very, very innovative project. As you can see in the timeline, PHP has been the first of the big mainstream programming languages to introduce a native package management system. In 2009, two big milestones happened in the PHP ecosystem: the introduction of namespace in PHP 5.3, and the creation of the first autoloading standard, PSC0, from the PHP FIG group, which is a group focused on defining interoperability standards between frameworks. Thanks to these two new innovations, a new and a modern package management manager was invented. It was Composer. I guess you all know it. But the question is why a new package manager was even created. We already had PEAR. Well, PEAR was created in another era of computer programming, before the advent, the invention of Git and the popular coding platforms like GitHub, GitLab, and such. In fact, PEAR packages are moderated by the PEAR team, meaning that you cannot simply publish a new module on the default PEAR channel by submitting your repo. There were also other big technical limitations, such as not having a bundle or a log file to describe your dependencies and make your code reproducible. As we can see from the graphs, Composer quickly became a big success with a broad adoption. Today, it hosts more than 300K of packages and over 3.5 million of revisions. With more than 2 billion installed packages monthly, so very, very big numbers. And now, let's see how Composer works right now to protect us from supply chain attacks with its built-in security features. We begin, when install a new package on Composer, we begin by defining a namespace, such as Drupal, followed by the library name and its version. And as you can see, only vendor namespace packages are allowed to be installed. And this is very important, very good security feature, because it reduces a lot the risks behind typo squatting attacks. The code on Composer is always hosted on a Git repository, and only metadata goes on packages.org. This is another significant security advantage, as it reduces the risks of code tampering. Anyway, the possibility of tampered metadata is still coming from the package default, the packages repo. It's still an actual risk. And then Composer allowed us to define multiple repositories in addition to the default public one, exactly as Drupal does with package.drupal.org repository. And when it is present, these repositories are considered canonical by default. This means that if a package name is found in a custom or private package repository, only the versions from that repositories are loaded. So we are not affected by another popular attack called dependency confusion, which that is hitting very hard other package managers like PyPy or npm and so on and so forth. Anyway, despite all these Composer built-in security features already in place, many supply chain attacks have been conducted against Composer and Pear only in the last 2 years, as you can see, and all of them were very dangerous too. For example, in May this year, an incident occurred on Composer when someone gained access to an inactive user account, becoming a maintainer for at least 14 packages. You can see more on the link on the slide, it's Composer blog. So what? Are we doomed? Where should we start to secure our PHP software supply chain? I guess that the first step we have to do is to look at our application and all its dependencies, the world dependencies map, as a single unit of code. And the way to achieve that, not reinventing the wheel, it is by using OCI containers, or AKA Docker containers. They allow us to define our application, all its dependencies, in a reproducible way using Docker files, and they are very easy to move between environments, from your local machine to the cloud or to your colleagues. They also allow us to rely on existing cloud-native ecosystem of tools to generate, for example, software bill of materials, digital signatures, and scan for vulnerabilities, and so on and so forth. Another important aspect is that containers today are also very useful for development with tools like DDEV, maybe most of you is using it, DrupalPod, GitHub Codespaces, recently even GitLab, and so on and so forth. Containers today basically are the lingua franca of software packaging. Let's see now what are the OCI images and how they work. OCI stands for Open Container Initiative. It is an initiative to define standards around container technologies such as runtime, image, and distribution. And an OCI container can store any kind of file, including arbitrary files, of course, not just what is defined by a Docker file. And we'll see in a moment why this feature is important. So the question now is how an OCI container can help us to improve the trust between us and a digital artifact. How can I be sure that what I'm running is coming from a trusted source? Well, this is essentially the same question that Ken Thompson, posed in 1984 in his famous paper, Reflections on Trusting Trust. And the answer was quite simply, we cannot really trust the code we don't totally write ourselves. Instead, we should put more trust on the people who wrote it. So, to wire the barrel of trust, we need to know at least who built it, when and how, using things like digital signatures and provenance attestations, for example. And we also need to know the list of things who made the artifact, basically like the list of ingredients we require when we buy some food, for example. And using digital signatures with key pairs, we can solve the first set of problems because they ensure integrity, authenticity, no repudiation, which are the key elements to building trust between actors. But the problem is that managing keys, it's very hard. It's a tough task. We have to distribute the keys to our users. We need to keep our private key in a very secure place, storage, and when compromised, not if, we have to inform all the involved user to use the new key, to deprecate the old one, and so on and so forth. So, super complex. This is why digital signatures today are not yet widely used by developers, even though they have existed for decades. But there is a new project called Sigstore from the OpenSSF Foundation aimed at resolving all those issues. With the goal to become what Let's Encrypt has been for TLS certificates. It is a very fast-growing community. It's already mainstream adopted, such as Kubernetes. Many other big vendors like GitHub, NPM, GitLab, Ruby, Arch, and so on and so forth. So the success of Sigstore is mostly driven by its very innovative features, like the keyless signing. It means not having any more keys to sign an artifact, and it works by using your public identity, like GitHub, Google, or whatever OpenID provider supported, to generate a short-lived certificate and use it to sign on your behalf. So you don't need keys, basically. Another important feature is that signatures are stored alongside the OCI registry. You remember the feature I mentioned before? So you don't have any more the distribution issues, because anyone know that the signatures are in alongside your Docker image, basically. The other key element in the software supply chain are the software bill of materials, known as SBOM. They represent a list of ingredients who made the artifact, and you can use it to do things like vulnerability scanning, license policy, find abandoned dependencies, whatever. And generating SBOM is a very complex problem to solve because dependencies are managed by different package managers at different layers, and they differ a lot on how they package stuff. Even just the Linux distributions have many kind of package types. Even if they share maybe the same package type, they apply patches or they release things with custom versions depending on the distribution. Then you have your programming language, you have PHP, you have JavaScript, you can have Python, and so on and so forth. There are, of course, various tools available that we can help, that can help to generate this bomb. The most advanced you can use today are Syft, Trivy, and even Docker now has a built-in SBOM generator, which eliminates the need to install something, another tool. And today we are announcing a new Drupal module, DrupalBOM, Drupal Bill of Materials. It is a very simple module, very easy to use for generating a full software bill of materials for your Drupal installation. I will show you how it works shortly. Well, finally, demo time. We are going to see mainly three things here: how to sign a Drupal container image with Sigstore, how to generate and attach this SBOM for the container to the registry. In the second part, I will show you this new Drupal module we are developing to bring together all these technologies and make them easily accessible from any environment, dockerized or not. To demonstrate how all this stuff works, I will deploy the container on a local Kubernetes cluster, which has some security policies, which will allow me, only to deploy containers with signatures and with SBOM attached. You can use this QR code to access the GitHub repo containing all the code to replicate this demo and how the things are implemented. All right, let's move to the video. Okay, we start by building our Docker file, basically. As you can see, it's a Drupal 10.1.5. We installed some composer dependencies. We installed some JavaScript dependencies and a system dependency. Then we installed two binaries because we need it in this application. And we run some scripts. It's quite simple, easy peasy. We build our image. We now are going to push this image to our Docker registry. And now we try to deploy this container to our Kubernetes cluster. And as I said, this cluster is running a security controller, security policy controller, which deny me to deploy this container because we are missing basically the signature and we are missing the SBOM. Let's go to fix all these failures. And we are using a tool from the Sigstore ecosystem, which is cosign. And as you can see, we just passed to cosign, sign command, our Docker image and the tag. And now we start the keyless signing process. I log with my GitHub account. I trade my identity for a short-lived certificate that cosign will use to sign my container. And it's done. Now, if I go to check my Docker registry, I can see that I have two tags. One is my image, the other one is the signature. So no more distribution issue. Anyone can check it. In fact, if you use cosign verify command with the image, with the tag, anyone can see who signed this image. And in this case, it was me, of course. There is my mail. I know that the issue was GitHub. Maybe I can provide some security policy to restrict just to some OpenID profile. And now I try to deploy again my container to the Kubernetes cluster. And you can see, now we have just one error because the SBOM is missing. And now we are going to generate an SBOM using a tool, which is Syft from the Anchor company. And it's super easy to use. You just need to pass to the tool your image and the tag. It will scan all the layers. And you will see all the packages installed on this container, not just Drupal. As you can see, the container was quite small. We installed just four composer dependencies. We installed one and node NPM dependency. We installed two binaries. And the result is that we are shipping somewhere a container with more than 3,000 packages, a lot. Now to attach it to our container, we are going to generate the SBOM in another format, which is CycloneDX. There are several. I choose this one, not for any specific reason. And it's a JSON format. It's perfect. It's machine readable. And it contains a lot of information, more than the table we saw before, of course. As the licenses, the author, where it has been found inside the container. For example, now we are checking the web profiler module, and now we know the license. We know it's pure. We know that is the name is Drupal web profiler, and so on and so forth. And now what we are going to do is attaching, it means pushing this SBOM automatically using cosign. We are going to attesting using the lingo of cosign this file to our Docker container, pushing it to the Docker registry and signing it. So we attest our image with the tag. We pass as predicate the file we have just generated, Drupal SBOM. Now we just say to cosign that the type of this file is a CycloneDX file. And now we start the keyless signing process because it will signing it with my identity and push it to the registry. So I am sure that who has generated this SBOM was me. In fact, now if you are checking the Docker registry, we can see that we have three tags. One is our Docker image 100, the other one was the signature, and the third one is the SBOM. And now finally, we try again to deploy this container to our Kubernetes cluster. Hopefully it will work. I know, because it's a video. Okay, it worked. It worked, wow. And now the second part, we are going to use just Drupal to generate the SBOM from the Drupal instance using our new module, DrupalCon. I'm going to check that the composer file basically contains what you saw in the Docker file before. We are just using a composer. It's a module. You can install it from Drupal.org. It's still in the development phase. Not yet released in any kind of version. We install it with Drush. And now it's ready to be used. We can go to admin reports SBOM. And we can see that we don't have yet generated an SBOM. We are going to generate it, of course. Wow, and now we know that in this installation we have 1,000 NPM packages, 1.NET binary. I didn't know what is that one, maybe from Composer, I guess. 54 GitHub actions and more than 200 PHP Composer files. And the result is this one. We have a lot of packages just for standard Drupal default installation with four composer modules. We can download this SBOM, of course, and then we can use it as well with Drush, of course, because maybe you want to use it programmatically, you want to use it in your CI. There are two commands right now. One is download, the other one is to generate a new one. Now we are going to generate a new SBOM with the Drush. We are going to save it in a file. And now we are going to inspect this file to see the content, just to be sure that everything worked as expected. We check again the web profiler module. Okay, everything is inside. We are going to check the NPM libraries as well to see what are and where are they come from. And now once you have an SBOM, you can do many stuff, and one of them is, for example, inspecting for known vulnerabilities like this using another tools, which is Grype. There are many, and you just pass your SBOM to Grype, and this tool will download the public CVEs to understand if your packages, your installed libraries, are vulnerable with something. Okay, now we have a new data that we have 29 vulnerability meshed, 3 critical, 15 high, 11 medium, and so on and so forth, all from the NPM ecosystem. Of course, you have to take with a grain of salt this kind of information, because CVs are quite flawed sometimes. And maybe you are not really in danger with this kind of vulnerability, depending on how you build the application. But this is data, you know. Maybe someone can request you to provide this kind of information from your Drupal code base. It works by relying to Syft binary. So you need this one for now, and it can generate the SBOM file in different formats. It will be saved in Drupal to get the most of it, to do data reporting, and etc. That's it. Okay. So, say welcome to DrupalCon. As we briefly saw during the demo, this module allows you to generate a full SBOM of a Drupal installation, parsing PHP and all the other dependencies found inside the code base. It is still in early stages of development, and any contribution is more than welcome to do things like vulnerability scanning with Grype, for example, better data reporting, more SBOM formats, CI tests, and so on and so forth. In fact, let me remember the contribution opportunities at rooms 4.1 and 4.2 till the end of the conference. So, to conclude, just some takeaways, as we saw a lot of stuff. OCI containers simplify a lot software packaging. I invite you to use it, to use them. Providing free access to modern cloud-native tooling, as we saw with Sigstore, with Syft, with the Grype to sign, to generate the SBOM, and to check for vulnerabilities and such. And we have a new module, DrupalCon, to easily generate SBOM from Drupal. And to finish, two important points that we didn't see in the demo, but they are very important. I invite you to automate your dependencies management with the tools like GitHub Dependabot if you are on GitHub, or better, using an open source project, which is RenovateBot on all other platforms, including GitHub. And finally, you can try to use this module, this composer library, Drupal Security Advisory's composer library that you find on GitHub. We are helping to maintain, which once installed, will inform you when you install or upgrade the package about known vulnerabilities of these modules using the Drupal Security Advisory database information. So it's quite good. It's easy to use. You have just to install it. So thank you.